internal counter of Miriam Star found, and 15 seconds later, the balloon. In we open the balloon before then mass right scale force to have such a tight sequence. Now what happened actually is 20 seconds into gem 4. Now we might do an intermediate test with a weather balloon, which would allow us at least to test all the onboard avionics, maybe the balloon inflation, but at least make a partial system test. That depends again on the availability of a free weather balloon flight. Now. We assume that the results we will get for the aerothermodynamic behavior of the balloon will provide information for the Mars balloon, but probably not enough in order to be able to risk a Mars mission. And in this case, we with high probability would have to plan for maybe a one-to-one mission. That means flying a one-to-one, a 10-meter balloon. In a very flat trajectory, which leaves then the balloon for a longer period of time in an atmosphere similar to Mars. That would be the objective. And then finally, if this schedule would be kept to give the go-ahead in 2014 for the development of the flight unit, for a launch of Archimedes to Mars in 2018. 2018 being a favorable launch window for going to Mars. The next one would be, I think, in 21. So you cannot just launch whenever you want. Now I'm giving some more details on the Miriam and Miriam 2 vehicles, which are very similar. Here you see, it's similar to the Mars mission, but this time it's going down to Earth, and obviously the atmospheric conditions comparable to Mars are only in a very small portion of the atmosphere. Now, the nominal mission which we would like to have is that the Miriam would be released from the rocket in about 90 kilometer altitude. Then the vehicle would continue to climb, and at 120 kilometers we would deploy the balloon. When we reach a peak altitude, the balloon would still be in the state of being in inflated, and then the balloon would enter the interesting parts of the Earth atmosphere in about 120 kilometer altitude, fully inflated, because the inflation will take about half a minute, and the total flight time is not very long. It's a purely parabolic trajectory. Now, the second vehicle will be very similar to the first one. That's why I will show you the first vehicle later on and then say what we will change. The most important part is to introduce the improvements which led to the mission failure. Of course, the actual development of the second mission vehicle started with the Beaulieu development already in 2009, so this is well in progress. And by the end of this year, we will give the go-ahead, hopefully, if all participants would agree and be able to participate with the full development of the flight vehicle. This is really the complexity you will see in the next few graphs. It's a complexity comparable to a small satellite. So you see here, this is the flight vehicle here. This is prior to the start in Kiruna in 2008. So here you see the vehicle weighs 37 kilograms. It is about 60 centimeters high. This is the rocket here. Then this is what we call camera module that comes also from our side, because here are seven cameras integrated which take movies in the first part when we are released and getting away to see if the balloon inflation has started. You see, this is the camera module. The separation plane is a little bit lower here, a couple of centimeters. And you see, this is a separation plane where we separate from the rocket and the camera module, and there's a second separation plane later on which separates the balloon from the inflation equipment. So it's rather complex. These are two booms. You will see in the next picture they are unfolded. These are the gas tanks, and of course the balloon in its folded condition is inside, and here you see kind of this release mechanism, which you see better in the next picture. Yeah, you see here, this is the vehicle without the super insulation. So here you see the deployed booms with the video cameras. Which the main purpose is to make movie, take pictures, take the video of the deployment, of the unfolding and deployment of the balloon up to release from the inflation equipment. So you see here the helium tanks, computers and power supply, of course, are inside the vehicle and inside the pod, which is integrated into the balloon. Now, this is the Miriam mission scenario. This is the rocket, this is the release of the vehicle, the unfolding of the balloon, the inflation of the balloon, and finally the entry into the Earth atmosphere. Now in the Earth atmosphere, as soon as the external pressure becomes bigger than the balloon pressure, the balloon will be pressed together and will be accelerated and fall down to Earth without real interest for the actual mission results. Now, what do we learn from Miriam 2? And what I mean here is, what do we learn for the Mars mission? And I made this in colors the different areas. The green is very similar, yellow is similar, and where we are not simulating at all, the Mars mission is red. So you see the balloon itself, the balloon pressure, the balloon manufacturing methods, the inflation and sealing approach with a windsock, which is for balloon people a well-known thing. You have a hose which goes into the balloon, and which then once the balloon is inflated, is pressed by the internal balloon pressure and against the skin, and then seals the air. Yeah, so it's a system in avoiding that you need additional valves to close the inflation chain. And the way the balloon is made with the integrated payload also is representative. So less representative is the balloon material. We would hope to get another balloon material for the Mars mission to have more margin. But this would cost us probably $2 million or something, while here this is off the shelf material, which is very cheap. So that's why I say it's representative. Then the packing and storage of the balloon is similar, but will be different. That depends on the configuration of the satellite we are flying with. The scientific instrumentation will be slightly different, extended, updated, and so on. And finally, the way in doing the measurement during descent of the balloon and treating the signals and sending them to the satellite and back will be similar. So here we will also collect information with Miriam. Okay, the balloon entry behavior, that is the one of the main objectives, to see if all the theoretical calculations, the scientific research is valid or not. And what is different is, of course, the deorbiting system. You will remember that I said we use the propulsion system of the satellite in order to decelerate us into an entry trajectory. This is very specific for the satellite and very suitable for us. If you fly with another satellite, the solution might be a different one, up to our own descent propulsion system. That's main. Now here you see the main objective of the test is this, to have similar ballistic coefficients, which as you see are very similar for Miriam and for Archimedes, and from that fact be able to translate the measurements during the thin atmospheric experimentation to compare this with the needs for the Mars mission. Now I will show you what really the development challenge is. I will do this all together. We have four different development phases of the balloon. The first one where we are doing packing and so on, I was already mentioning. The second one was the development of a rather representative 1 to 2.5 flight balloon, that means 4 meter diameter, which was used for the Miriam flight. We will now use the time we have for the next mission to improve the balloon, and I will show you which areas we intend to improve. Improvement means to make it closer to the Mars mission. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Okay, this is the complete balloon. Here you see the inflation hose, and up there you barely see it is the instrumentation pot. Now, without going into detail, there you see how many parameters are important for the balloon design. For the performance, it must have a low mass.